1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, end of test. This Houston, contact with the test 1. Roger, gear lock clear here. Also.
Thought of Switzerland as a space nation? Probably not. And yet, from the first flag on the moon to atomic clocks, Switzerland is no stranger to the space field. From fundamental research to innovative technologies or business plans, Switzerland is the host of companies, startups, and laboratories. To discuss these topics, I have the privilege to welcome two actors from space innovation in Switzerland. Dr. Ursula Oesterle, Vice President of Innovation at EPFL, and Professor Volker Gass, Head of the Space Innovation Unit. Volker, Ursula, welcome on the moon. Did you have a safe flight?
Well, the gravity is a little bit low here, so I have to hold on to my chair, but otherwise it was fine.
Yeah, you have to get used to it.
Yes, definitely.
But we made it.
Could you introduce yourself a bit more?
Sure. So my name is Volker Gass, and since 10 years, I've been heading the Space Innovation Unit, formerly called the Swiss Space Center. Working with students, with industry, and hosted in the Vice Presidency of Innovation. And actually, I love space and everything associated to it.
I'm Ursula. I just joined EPFL 3 months ago as Vice President of Innovation. My background is open innovation, startups, this interface between research, academia, startups, and corporates. So this is a perfect place and perfect play field. As a physicist, you know, space has always been fascinating. For me, it was always either go scuba diving or into space because of three-dimensional freedom.
So when we hear Switzerland, we often think about cheese, chocolate, watches, but usually not exoplanets, space debris, or rocket fairings. If I tell you Switzerland, a space nation, what three words come into mind?
Claude Nicollier.
Astrophysics.
High-tech.
Mars rover.
Velcro.
Oh, you got me there. space beer.
Space beer. Could you explain that?
Oh yes, well, during my PhD, we worked on a bioreactor to make yeast in microgravity, so in space. And the yeast cell used was a cerveza yeast, meaning the beer yeast. So actually, we built the smallest miniature microbrewery and we flew it on the space shuttle.
Impressive. Actually, another fun fact is that few people know that Switzerland was one of the first nations on the moon, Volker, right?
Yes, right. This is with Apollo 11, we know when the Americans landed on the moon. Well, they set up a flag, but the first flag they set up was actually a flag that came from Switzerland. And they set it up even before they set up the American flag. Quite cool.
Very cool, I want to say. And here at EPFL, Ursula, we have lots of cool space-related research. Do you have a couple of examples in mind?
Well, we have a very broad scope. For example, Professor Jamie Pike, she does really cool design and manufacture of robots. For example, what they can be used to clean the space stations. We have Professor Jean-Paul Kneipp. He's a classical hardcore astrophysics, which looks at the history and the origin of universe, and also the expansion of the galaxies. So, you know, we have both extremes. And then we have Professor Sophia Hausener. She focuses on renewable energy. And so here she's really looking for ways to store or to conversion of renewable energies into materials. And there she has a project on the solar flux to test materials. So it's a very broad scope of things that we have.
Indeed. And how do you transfer this research to the industry?
Well, there are two approaches. Either there's some really great research coming out of a lab, and then we kind of look at it whether we can take a spin out of it. Or the other way, the industry comes with a problem that they have, and then we try to go very early with the industry to the research labs to make sure from the very early point on there's a collaboration and a connection so that they then can make sure that what comes out of research satisfies the needs of the industry. So it's a push and a pull.
We have more than 80 companies working in the space field here in Switzerland, more visible one being RUAG, EPCO, or Maxen. Volker, for you, what is the Swiss specialty?
I think everything that is high tech, everything that is a challenge, everything that has to be really reliable, that you can't really make a recall on a satellite. So once it's up there, it's up there and has to work, and sometimes for 15 years, which is not the case of all cars or all smartphones. So we like to push the frontiers, and as we are a nation where the cost of living and the salaries are pretty high, we can only go into this high added value segment. And this is what most of the companies do in Switzerland that are active in the space field.
And at EPFL, Ursula, we have lots of startups as well.
Yes, exactly. As we mentioned before, startups come out. For example, Astrocast. Mm. Even today, a lot of the surface on the planet does not have connectivity. And so Astrocast has built a global network of microsatellites that allow sensors anywhere in the world to be connected. Then we have things like Swiss 212. Here it's about antennas. The challenge is how to do sophisticated antennas, and it becomes more and more complex. So they're using 3D printing and advanced manufacturing techniques to really do that. And one of our young ones is actually Clear Space, because as everywhere, humans are putting trash and derbies, and we actually have to clean up the space too. Can you believe it? We've already reached a level where we have to clean up space. So Clear Space, they actually grab the trash in the world and then they burn it. So this is a really, really cool new startup.
And Volker, EPFL is not the only university in Switzerland with a strong space department.
Oh, no. Phew. I mean, it's difficult not to forget any, but there is University of Geneva and Bern that are doing astrophysics, then University of Lausanne, University of Neuchâtel, University of Zurich that have their science fields, remote sensing, even the University of the Italian part of Switzerland, the USI, is working on GNSS, so global navigation components, and then the universities of applied sciences. I mean, here in the Swiss Romande, or in the northwestern part of Switzerland, or in the central Switzerland, Lucerne, the eastern Switzerland. I mean, so there's lots of activities. And then we have RTOs, research technology organizations, such as the CSEM, IAVAG, EMPA, the World Radiation Center in Davos, and everyone has a specialty and really pushing the technology and the research further.
Only that.
Well, maybe I forgot one, but...
Ursula, why are we so interested in space here in Switzerland or at EPFL? What is the added value?
The question should be, why not? How can anybody not be interested in space? Come on, it's...
I agree.
I mean, you're on there. So there is so much high tech in space. It's a very demanding environment. So from research point of view, it's cool. You, like Volker said, you cannot bring back the satellites. It's extreme environments. And it's one of the last frontiers where there's really exploration to go. As you can see, all the initiatives going on to Mars and things. So that's really cool. And then for me as a physicist, I come from the metaphysics sites, you know, the origin of life and spirituality. There is an attractiveness to that too. So, hey. Yeah. We should really.
And Volker, do you have examples of technologies that are developed for space, but that we use every day here on Earth?
Oh, sure. So, as Ursula said earlier, the Velcro, for example, was thought of in Switzerland even in 1948 and then developed in the Apollo program in the 60s. And I mean, I think everybody knows what a Velcro is. I don't think it was called Velcro initially. But more seriously, all the technologies developed for the remote sensing, I mean, Earth observation, really help us to understand meteorological services, the climate, but even more than that, to understand how the Earth functions. And I mean, we only have one blue planet, the one we are on, and if we don't understand it and don't take care of it, we're going to have a problem in the future. I mean, Earth is a spaceship also, not only the moon, but we need to plant a lot of trees on the moon to be able to live there on a more permanent basis.
Of course, the space helps us to live here on Earth, but also to discover other worlds, as Switzerland actually hosts two scientists, Michel Mayor and Didier Queloz, who had the Nobel Prize for discovering the first exoplanet. So I think we've seen that Switzerland is at the forefront in terms of innovation and research, thanks to EPFL and many other institutions. But chocolate is still a must, whether in space or on Earth. Volker, I've heard our chocolate can even fly to the space station.
Yes, in 2014, we decided that these poor astronauts, you know, only dehydrated foods and stuff. So we figured that let's send them some Swiss chocolate. So we made a plan with the European Space Agency, the support of the Swiss government, and we sent actually 6 boxes of crafted chocolate coming from Switzerland. that we sent out to the space station. And in 2015, Tim Peake sent back a thank you note holding a chocolate in his hand. But yeah, I must say, I mean, we are humble as Swiss people, as you know. And just like on the solar wind experiment of the University of Bern, which was the first flag from Switzerland planted on the moon, there's no visible logo of Switzerland on it. We did not put a logo of EPFL or of space innovation on the chocolate. But actually, in our hearts, we know where we are and what we are worth.
And now everybody knows.
And now everybody knows.
Amazing. Thank you, Ursula. Thank you, Volker, for making the trip and giving us a spacey overview of our country.
It's
Thank you very much.
Here.
It's a pleasure.
There is now no doubt that Switzerland is a space nation. But how will we remain a key actor in the years to come? This is when institutions like EPFL come into play. And to answer this question, I welcome Emmanuelle David, manager of the EPFL Space Center. Hello, Emmanuelle. Welcome on the moon. Is the campus better than the original one?
Yeah, it's an exciting campus. I feel much lighter here.
What is your role exactly as the manager of the EPFL Space Center?
My role is to coordinate the activities of the Space Center, which is overseeing the minor in space technologies of EPFL, coaching some students for students' projects, and also boosting space-related research at EPFL.
And how would you summarize space at EPFL?
Well, space is everywhere at EPFL. First, we have two units, eSpace and Space Innovation, which are looking at new trends in space and also starting innovative interdisciplinary projects. One of these is the research initiative on sustainable space logistics, and for example, we look at space debris, on-orbit servicing, but also new space economy. On the other hand, we are also helping and working with the labs at EPFL to apply their research for space. This can be in the field of materials, but also robotics, also quantum physics, but also Earth observation, artificial intelligence, and imaging analysis. So space is really everywhere.
And this research often translates then to startups. Do you have also examples?
Yes, indeed, we are very proud. We have two startups that I want to talk about, so PicTerra and ClearSpace. So PicTerra, they are working in the field of Earth observation. Nowadays, you have like tons of images with very high resolution. And they've built up this platform for people to be able to count whatever they want on Earth and to use those satellite imaging using some artificial intelligence products. So they are really bringing this huge amount of data to the people. The other company is ClearSpace. We're very proud of ClearSpace. It's a spin-off from our center. And they're working on-orbit servicing using technologies that have been developed at EPFL since 2012, using artificial intelligence and machine learning for the relative navigation system, but also the robotics knowledge for the capture system, for example.
And it usually starts with motivated and passionate students. Is there a way to specialize in space at EPFL?
Yeah, indeed. At EPFL, you have the minor in space technologies, and it's the only one in Switzerland. Students from any schools, so engineering, but also computer science, but as well as life science and even architecture, can come and take part of this minor. They will choose among the 26 classes on space technologies, perform also a semester project related to space, and then they have completed this minor in space technologies. Many of our alumni have created startups, are part of space agencies, and are also in the main space companies.
And EPFL is also well known for its MAKE project, this initiative to have hands-on work outside of their studies. Do you think it's also part of the innovation that we do here?
Exactly. The MAKE projects are amazing opportunities. At eSpace, we have the chance to follow six of those projects. So we have the rocket team, the spacecraft team, you have Robot Hub. They develop a robot to grow autonomously vegetables for exploration purposes. You have also the Space Situational Awareness team, the rover team, and also Asclepios, which are developing analog mission for students by students that you know well as you created this project. The MAKE projects are really great because the students can apply what they learn in the class in a project. But also, they can learn what you don't have in books, like intercultural projects, but also stakeholder management, conflict management, how to deal with deadlines. It means the students that went through the MEG projects, when they start working, they will be efficient from day one. And to be honest, I'm really jealous about them. I really wished I had that back then when I was studying.
And another amazing opportunity we have is we have the privilege to have the only Swiss astronaut as professor in the minor, Cloné Collier, who went to space 4 times. And I actually had the pleasure to welcome him at the Galactic Chloé show a few weeks ago.
I'm Cloné Collier. I was an ESA astronaut for many years. In fact, I was selected in the first group in 1978. Originally, I was an astrophysicist and a pilot in the Air Force in Switzerland. Became an astronaut in the first group together with Ulf Merbold and Vubo Ockels, 1978, long time ago, 43 years ago. Then I was assigned to the Johnson Space Center, Houston, to train on the space shuttle. Spent 12 years in Houston before my first flight, which was in 1992. But after this first flight, it was bang, 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 3 more flights in the 90s. And I had the great privilege to be able to go and visit the Hubble Space Telescope on 2 occasions. This was wonderful. I left ESA in 2007, and now I'm teaching at the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology in Lausanne, EPFL, with pleasure. I teach space technology, and all that I learned during these 25 years in Houston, I'm teaching to students now. Great pleasure.
Emmanuel, how do you see the future of space exploration at EPFL and in Switzerland?
Well, the future of space exploration is bright. At EPFL, we have this initiative, Let's Go to the Moon, and we aim to have EPFL technologies on the moon by the end of the decade. Also, currently, there is the selection for the next class of astronauts, and we are really looking forward to see one of our alumni in the next astronaut cohort. As you see, there are many opportunities, and the future is really bright.
Space in innovation, research, education. Switzerland is everywhere. Thank you, Emmanuel, for making the trip and visiting us at the Galactic Chloé Show.
Thank you, Chloé.
We end this episode on a high note, and we hope that next time you will hear the word Switzerland, you will think innovation in the space field. Don't hesitate to come by at Vivatech to discover some of those amazing technologies that make Switzerland a space nation.